Writer Jennifer Egan has intrigued readers and critics with her experimental novels Look at Me and The Keep. Her newest work, A Visit from the Goon Squad, explores the changing music industry, nostalgia, time, and much more. Jennifer Egan joins me now. Welcome.
Thank you.
I have read where you've said that you thought this novel is about time. What does that mean?
Well, I was reading a lot of Proust, and I was interested in trying to write a book about time today. And I think I was particularly interested because of the huge technological changes that we're going to, that we're going through. And I found myself very drawn to the music industry, which has been in kind of a free fall in recent years, as we all know.
Well, why was music the way in to telling the story of a? It's a group of characters. It begins in the 1970s San Francisco, very specific music scene, right?
I think for a few reasons. I think for one thing, all of us remember those teenage years and the songs that we fell in love with and the music scene that we were part of. So in a certain way, music cuts through time like almost nothing else. You know, it makes us feel like we're back in an earlier moment. And then I think on the other side, the music industry is an interesting lens through which to look at change because it has had such a difficult time adjusting to the digital age. So it felt a little like all roads led to the music industry. I also had just had a yen to write about it for years. I had tried as a journalist and never could quite make it happen. So it was my chance to finally dive in and learn about
that
industry.
You know, you're known for these interesting books and different styles all the time. Where do you start? I mean, was it starting with, as you say, a yen to write about music, or?
I think it was a couple of things. I was interested in writing about time and about music, but actually what started it was standing in a hotel bathroom, washing my hands, looking down and seeing a wallet lying in plain view. And I have been robbed a number of times. I've had my wallet stolen in all kinds of situations, and I thought, that poor woman, someone might take her wallet. And then I thought, but I'm the only person here. And it led to one of those fictional leaps where I thought, okay, who is the woman who would take that wallet and why?
And that's how the novel starts.
I started with that, and I basically just started with that moment and went. And in the course of writing the first chapter about the woman who takes the wallet, I found myself intrigued by a mention of her former boss, whom I wrote. I found her saying that he sprinkled gold flakes in his coffee and sprayed pesticide in his armpits, and he's a record producer. And at the time I thought, well, that's just sort of a music thumbnail sketch. But ultimately I thought, who is he and why does he do those things? And that led me into this music producer, Benny Salazar, who is in a way in a state of mourning over the direction the industry has gone in, and also for his own. He's heading into middle age and thinking a lot about his years as a punk rocker in San Francisco, which then led me to write about San Francisco in the late 70s, where I was a high school student, going to punk rock clubs on occasion. So one thing
was
led to...
Was the hair spiky at that time?
The hair was pretty much as it is now,
okay.
Actually.
Okay.
I didn't have the guts to spike my hair. Mm-hmm. But anyway, so I found myself following one impulse after another in this very non-linear way.
Yeah, because that's where I wanted. I mean, you said it led you to write about 1970s, but in fact, non-linear is the key to this thing. You go in and out of time. We meet a character one point, and then later on in his or her life, and then spinning back. Why that? I guess that goes to the sense of time, right? As different moments of time.
Well, I had the thought of just going backwards because initially as I was writing these chapters, I was moving backwards. Mm. But then I found that the power, the whole didn't seem to be greater than the sum of the parts when I followed that backwards format. I think what I was most interested in were the moments of surprise when we realize that time has passed. You know, it's moving slowly and incrementally, but we only notice it in sudden quantum leaps where we think, oh, this has changed. And the change always feels surprising, which in itself is surprising because change is so constant. So I was interested in getting at those little surprises amongst a group of people over many years. And it seemed like the best way to do that, to try to twist it in as many ways as I could, was to move in and out of time rather than solidly forward or backward.
Well, you know, earlier I used the word novel, and there is this sort of inevitable question about what it is that you've written here. They're stories, they're linked, but they're not linked even in the normal way, if there is such a thing as normal. It's not plotted as a kind of standard novel. What do you see yourself as having done?
Well, I was not sure myself as I went along, and I worried about that. I thought, well, this isn't a conventional novel, and it's not really a story collection. And then I thought, who cares? It's a work of fiction, and I'm basically following my instinct. My goal was that it be exciting and gripping and fun, honestly. And I thought, if I can do all those things, who cares what we call it?
I mean, I guess the answer to who cares might be the publisher, right? I mean, if they have to market something like this.
Yes.
That's maybe beyond what you're doing as you sit down to write, but does that become an issue?
It hasn't, although I wondered what they would say when I gave them this, and I really wondered when I added a chapter after I had already sold them the book, and I wrote that chapter in PowerPoint. So that's an example of the kinds of way, the different odd ways I tried to find to tell these different stories that I was interested in. And the PowerPoint chapter takes place in the future, and it's narrated by a 12-year-old girl who keeps her journal in slide form. So she's writing about her family life in slides. And that was, I thought that was kind of interesting and kind of fun. The chapter is called Great Rock and Roll Pauses, and it's very much about her brother, who has a kind of Asperger's obsession with the pauses in rock and roll songs. And using PowerPoint let me show these pauses in a visual way that would have been impossible in conventional fiction. So again, if I had worried too much about what I was doing and whether it fit into the right category, I might not have done that. But I think that it adds power and, honestly, fun to the book.
It also goes to what you were talking about earlier, this notion of technology, how it's changing us and how it changes the culture. In this case, it's how it changes perhaps you as a writer and the form you take.
Well, the funny thing is I actually write by hand. So in a way, I wouldn't...
You write by hand?
I really do. I'm not a technophobe, really? But I'm pretty old-fashioned. I write on legal pads by hand. I use the computer as a typing machine. Yeah. So initially, I tried doing my PowerPoint chapter by hand, which was, of course, a total non-starter. I didn't even own PowerPoint. I had never used it. But I was curious about the fact that it has become such a ubiquitous genre. And I thought, okay, this is a way people are telling stories now. How could fiction work in this genre? Also, you know, in terms of the subject of that chapter, the pauses in these songs, the thing that's so compelling about a pause in a rock and roll song is that you wonder for a moment if the song has ended. Then the song continues, and there's this kind of relief. Okay, I'm still listening to the song, and then the song actually does end. I think metaphorically that really interested me in a book about time. There are all these pauses in our lives that make us think about the big pause, or sort of the pause that's all around us. And I think it was compelling to me in that way, and that PowerPoint allowed me to explore it in a more vivid way than I could have otherwise.
All right, last thing. A lot is made about the different, that all your books are so different. One reviewer was saying that each of her books could have been written by a different writer, so distinct are they in setting and style. Do you agree with that? And if so, why? Is that just you as a writer exploring different things?
You know, I try consciously to keep myself entertained and challenged to not repeat myself at all. Like when I start a new book, my goal is to pretty much throw out what I've done and try something completely different that I think initially I cannot do. That's what makes it challenging for me and makes me able to grow as a writer. And honestly, it keeps it fun because I want to try to do something I've never done and write about a world and ideally in a way technically that I've never taken on before. So I'm glad to hear that. I think there are a lot of thematic connections between the books, but stylistically and in terms of voice and subject and content, I have tried to make them really diverse.
All right. The new one is A Visit from the Goon Squad. Jennifer Egan, thanks for talking to us.
Thanks so much.